Good morning, beautiful souls. So I woke up this morning and I'm lying in bed. And I say, Father, what shall you have me do today? And I feel this inner knowing, this inner rising, just kind of whisper to me and say, today's a video day. And I was like, oh, okay. I'm excited to see what we're going to read. And so I really feel that it's just time to read another part in the course. And I feel like I've really missed being able to record the videos and go from beginning to end with the flow of the Holy Spirit and let kind of the whole vision of it be given me as I teach it, as I share it. And so I think that this is perfect timing. And so the part in the A Course in Miracles that really, really stuck out for me today was in chapter 10, page 250 from the Sparkly, if you have the Sparkly version, but it is called The Problem and the Answer. And I can't help but think that this is the one that has come forward to be communicated about today, because there's been a theme that's been going on in the last week, I want to say. And that theme is that basically my friends and my family are calling me, kind of reaching out. Sometimes they're reaching out just to say hello and then it gets into this conversation, but sometimes they reach out because they're really in difficult situations. And so I find that it always came back around to the recognition that there is only one problem and that there is only one solution. Because it seems that in life, especially when we go through this process of awakening or shifting our goals, shifting our purpose, going through the process of, you know, the awakening of consciousness in the mind, that shift in goal, that shift in purpose really disrupts the ego's plan. And so the ego fights back a lot more. And so it's as if all of the relationships in our life become distorted. It can be really kind of a difficult and intense period of time. And so I'm just kind of recognizing this in the lives of my friends and allowing it to kind of reflect to me when I went through the same thing. And so anything that's like lingering that I still find kind of maybe touches something in my own mind that's still present, I'm able to look at it with them. And so it's a really kind of healing process. And I find it does come in waves. Sometimes it's like everybody's calling me, and then there'll be times when nobody's calling me. So this winter was kind of like a winter of solitude for me. And it was really, really introspective. And so I find now we're coming out closer to that time of spring, and it's like, here comes all the rising questions and seeming problems. And so instead of looking at them as individual problems, problems in my relationships, problems with my parents, problems with money, problems with work, let's just remember that they all are bottled up as one problem. And that one problem is the thought of separation. And ultimately, the one answer is that of unity. So the separated mind of ego, the united mind of God. And so we're going through literally a change of mind here that can seem really kind of difficult at the beginning phases, but we're remembering that there's a goal, there's a light at the end of the tunnel, so we're going to work through the hard stuff to ultimately get to the peace, the joy, and the new world that we can bring here through that vision. And so let's get into reading today and see where it takes us. So again, the problem and the answer. So I'm just going to kind of be still here for a moment. Problem and the answer. The world as you perceive it cannot have been created by the Father, for the world is not as you see it. God created only the eternal, and everything you see is perishable. Therefore, There must be another world which you do not see. The Bible speaks of a new heaven and a new earth. Yet this cannot be literally true, for the eternal are not recreated. To perceive anew is merely to perceive again, implying that before or in the interval, you were not perceiving at all. What, then, is the world that awaits your perception when you see it? Every loving thought that the Son of God ever had is eternal. Those which his mind perceived in this world are the world's only reality. They are still perceptions because he still believes that he is separate. Yet they are eternal because they are loving. And being loving, they are like the Father and therefore cannot die. The real world can actually be perceived. All that is necessary is a willingness to perceive nothing else. For if you perceive good and evil, you are accepting both the false and the true, and making no distinction between them. Beautiful. I'm going to pause here for 1 second, because I think this is really opening up in the recognition that there is a new heaven and there is a new world that we literally can actually perceive here. And so at first, we're taught to see this world has many differences, many different colors, many different races, many different religions, many different beliefs. At first, we're taught that these different religions and beliefs and countries all fight against each other when something goes wrong. We are taught to judge. We are taught to protect ourselves and protect our bodies and protect our families against the outer world of evil. This is the conditioning that has been brought upon every single mind that enters Earth. And from this whole experience of the thought of being separate from everyone, separate from nature, separate from animals, separate from the people that live on Earth, separate from the Earth itself, separate from God, because this separation is the foundation of our whole worldly experience here, the only way that we are actually going to perceive the new earth and the new world is by letting that thought of separation be changed to that of unity, so that we can look upon only that which is loving, which is eternal, which is God. And so we are being reminded here that every loving thought that we've ever had is true and will always be true and will always remain in God and remain eternal. So from these loving thoughts can create an entirely new world. But that must mean that we want these loving thoughts and nothing else. That's the crucial part, and nothing else. So this is why our life is our training ground. It's like our training wheels. And so what we are learning is to no longer see evil in the world or see evil in our brother or judge our brother in any way, not even this much. Because when we've judged our brother or we've seen evil or hatred or attack in our brother, something we hate about our brother, then those are the blocks that are allowing us to, those are the blocks that are standing in our way from recognizing that our Father God is perfect love, and our love, our perfect loving Father, loves us wholly perfect and all of his sons, including the ones that you think that you hate. And so this is crucial parts here. So a willingness to perceive nothing else but these loving thoughts. All right, carrying on. The ego sees some good, but never only good. That is why its perceptions are so variable. It does not reject goodness entirely, for that you could not accept. But it always adds something that is not real to the real, thus confusing illusion with reality. illusion and reality. For perceptions cannot be partially true. If you believe in truth and illusion, you cannot tell which is true. To establish your personal autonomy, you tried to create unlike your father, believing that what you made to be capable of being unlike him. Yet everything in what you have made that is true is like him. Only this is the real world, and perceiving only this will lead you to the real heaven because it will make you capable of understanding it. I think even the crucial thing to recognize here is that it's willingness. It is willingness to see only the good, to see only the loving, and to recognize that that is our true reality, to see only the good and only the loving, because only the loving and only the good are of God, and God is eternal. So God's characteristics never change. God's characteristics don't turn from love to fear. That's the ego that turns to fear. And so when we have that willingness to see only the good and to see only the loving and to give only the good and to give only the loving, that is where we bear witness to heaven, the reality of heaven here. But at first, it's a process of not really knowing the difference between what is illusion and what is reality. And so we get caught kind of seeing things in right perspective, but then adding our own thoughts of ego on top of it, which make it a very, very confusing matter. And so we're learning to almost like sort out the true from the false so that we can finally choose, okay, I want the truth and only the truth and nothing but the truth. As God sees it and not as man sees it. And so to continue. The perception of goodness is not knowledge, but the denial of the opposite of goodness enables you to perceive a condition in which opposites do not exist. I'm going to read that sentence again, just because it's a big one. The perception of goodness is not knowledge, but the denial of the opposite of goodness enables you to perceive a condition in which opposites do not exist. See, there's like two active parts in this sentence. One is the perception of goodness. Sure, we can perceive the good in all people and all things. But the second step to that is the denial of the opposite of goodness. And that's the part we seem to forget, because that's the part the ego wants to hold on to. Just like we just finished saying in the paragraph before, ego won't reject all goodness because it needs some good and some bad to keep itself alive. Because if it was only bad, we would realize just how obliterated crazy it is and either kill ourselves off or surrender to God. And so he doesn't really want either of that. It wants us to control it with the goal, control our life with the goal of death, but not quite take us to the death point, you know, to keep us in the suffering realm. And so when we realize that ego sees some good, but not only good, then we get to recognize that there is a perception of goodness that we can acquire. That leads to the direction of knowledge, but not quite knowledge itself. But we also not only have to perceive the goodness, but we have to deny the opposite of goodness, because the opposite of goodness is ego. And so by denying the opposite of goodness, then we become wholly focused on only the goodness, and we recognize that in this place of seeing only the goodness, that there is no opposite. Just like with our Father God, he's love, he's good, he's holy, there is no opposite in our eternal Father. And therefore, there must not be an opposite in us. But first, we're learning to see this. And once we see this in our brothers with the help of the Holy Spirit, we will see it in ourselves, accept it in ourselves, and now we can give this gift to all of our brothers and sisters and be in heaven here. But the first step, perception of goodness and denying the opposite of the goodness. And this is the condition of knowledge. Ha ha. The condition of knowledge is the perception of goodness without an opposite. And this is the condition of knowledge. Without this awareness, you have not met its conditions. And until you do, you will not know that it is yours already. You have made many ideas which you have placed between yourselves and your Creator. And these beliefs are the world as you perceive it. Truth is not absent here, but it is obscure. You do not know the difference between what you have made and what God created, and so you do not know the difference between what you have made and what you have created. And so I feel this is exactly what we are being, you know, letting the light come on in our minds today, is recognizing that God created only the good, God created only the loving, God created only the eternal. And so there's no opposite to that. But what we are also realizing is that we made an opposite to goodness. We made suffering, pain, and death. We made the physicality of this world. And so we are seeing here that the instant that we are willing enough to learn how to look upon goodness and only goodness without opposite, it is only then that we have met the condition for knowledge. It is only then that we have met the condition for the direct experience of God. So prior to that experience of knowledge and the direct experience of God, we must meet the conditions for it. And those conditions are recognizing that there is only goodness and love, which is the truth. Anything opposite of that is what we have made up. And so when we recognize that I have an emotion, or I have a thought, or I have an experience, or I have a judgment that is arisen, that is the opposite of good and loving, well, then that is my opportunity to connect with my inner teacher and to let my mind be healed. Because we are willing and wanting to see only the good and only the loving as God sees it, so we can literally bring the new world here. Here you go. To believe that you can perceive the real world is to believe that you can know yourself. You can know God because it is His will to be known. The real world is all that the Holy Spirit has saved for you out of what you have made. And to perceive only this is salvation, because it is the recognition that reality is only what is true. It should be becoming clear here. I'm going to read this sentence again. The real world is all that the Holy Spirit, that inner guide, the real world is all that the Holy Spirit has saved for you out of what you have made. And to perceive only this is salvation, because it is the recognition that reality is only what is true. This is a very simple course. Perhaps you do not feel that a course which, in the end, teaches nothing more than that only reality is true is necessary. But do you believe it? When you have perceived the real world, you will recognize that you did not believe it. Yet the swiftness with which your new and only real perception will be translated into knowledge will leave you only an instant to realize that this judgment is true. So we are realizing that the only way to see reality, the only way to see the kingdom of heaven, and the only way to basically have salvation is by seeing the real world through the eyes of the Holy Spirit, which is seeing only loving and seeing only goodness in our brothers and in this world. And this is why we need mind training. Because as we were speaking before, we are not taught that when we grow up here. We do not believe that at the beginning here. We are taught the opposite of that, actually. So this is why we need a reversal of our thinking. So to continue. And then everything you made will be forgotten, the good and bad, the false and the true. For as heaven and earth become one, even the real world will vanish from your sight. The end of the world is not its destruction, but its translation into heaven. The reinterpretation of the world is the transfer of all perception to knowledge. The Bible tells you to become as little children. Little children recognize that they do not understand what they perceive, and so they ask what it means. Do not make the mistake of believing that you understand what you perceive, for its meaning is lost to you. Yet the Holy Spirit has saved its meaning for you, and if you will let Him interpret it for you, He will restore what you have thrown away. As long as you think you know its meaning, you will see no need to ask Him of it. Amen. And I really do believe this is why the beginning lessons of the A Course in Miracles are nothing I see means anything. We literally have to accept that idea that nothing I see means anything before we can accept the meaning that the Holy Spirit has given it. And so today, we are coming to the point of recognizing that the whole point is to wake up from this dream, not to have another shifting dream. And the only way to wake up out of this dream is to allow this dream to become a happy dream, and then it's gone completely. We're all back to heaven. And we're being reminded that, you know, the end of the world is not its destruction, but its translation into heaven. So the world doesn't have to end through war and chaos. The war can be, the world can be translated into heaven so that we reach a place of peace, the happy dream, and then can wake up from the happy dream into complete heaven itself. But we are also reminded here that the Bible says to become like little children. And the reason that this is so is because little children go, "What's that, Mom? What's that, Dad? What's that? What's that?" And they learn from their parents. Whereas now we are remembering that our parent is God. And so when I say, "What's this world? What's this? What's that? What's this?" I'm asking this to the Holy Spirit, the voice for God, that is here to teach me how I am to truly see it through true perception. And so now we are asking the right authority, the authority of the Holy Spirit, the authority of the voice for God that is in our mind. So when we get to the point of realizing that nothing has meaning, that everything only has meaning to that which I have given it, but I'm willing to take off my meaning because I do not know, and obviously I don't know because I'm not at peace. Therefore, in this moment of recognizing that there's nothing has meaning, I don't know what anything means, I'm not at peace, it is in this instant that we can ask the Holy Spirit to teach us what it means. That's the Holy Spirit's job. That's the Holy Spirit's function. And this is the one relationship with which we are cultivating, that it may automatically be cultivated in all our brothers because the Holy Spirit is in them too. So this is where the true healing happens again. Ask what something means. Become like little children. Ask the voice for God. So to continue. You do not know the meaning of anything you perceive. Not one thought you hold is wholly true. Not one thought you hold is wholly true. The recognition of this is your firm beginning. You are not misguided. You have accepted no guide at all. Instruction in perception is your great need, for you understand nothing. Recognize this, but do not accept it, for understanding is your inheritance. Perceptions are learned, and you are not without a teacher. Yet your willingness to learn of him depends on your willingness to question everything you have learned of yourself. For you who have learned amiss should not be your own teachers. Well, that's it. We've learned amiss because we have been our own teachers. And so that's why we don't know anything, because we've been our own teachers. That's why nothing has any meaning, because we've been our own teachers. How can we teach ourselves when we don't know anything? But what we are really learning here is that we actually have a teacher, the teacher of the Holy Spirit. And the teacher of the Holy Spirit can instruct us in our perception to see only the real world here, to see only the good, to see only the loving, because that is the Holy Spirit's job. The Holy Spirit is the answer to the separation. The Holy Spirit is the answer to this world. And so as we let ourselves be taught by this teacher and have the willingness to learn of him, then that willingness will allow us to truly, truly, truly no longer be our own teachers, learn from him, and finally have peace and bear witness to the real world so we can help others see it too. So no one can withhold truth except from himself. Yet God will not refuse the answer he gave you. Ask then, for what is yours but which you did not make, and do not defend yourself against truth. You made the problem which God has answered you. You made the problem which God has answered. ask yourselves, therefore, but one simple question. Do I want the problem, or do I want the answer? Do I want the problem, or do I want the answer? I made the problem. God has given the answer. Do I want the problem, or do I want the answer? Decide for the answer, and you will have it. For you will see it as it is, and it is yours already. You complain that this course is not sufficiently specific for you to understand it and use it. Yet it has been very specific, and you have not done what it specifically advocates. This is not a course in the play of ideas, but in their practical application. Nothing could be more specific than to be told very clearly that if you ask, you will receive. How clear is that? When you ask, you will receive. So when you ask for the answer, you will receive it, but you must want the answer. And you must ask for and want the answer from the teacher who knows it, the Holy Spirit. So nothing could be more specific than to be told very clearly that if you ask, you will receive. The Holy Spirit will answer every specific problem as long as you believe that problems are specific. His answer is both many and one, as long as you believe that the one is many. Realize that you are afraid of his specificity for fear of what you think it will demand of you. Realize that you are afraid of his specificity for fear of what you think will demand of you. That's kind of the thought of sacrifice, right? Thinking that when I receive God's answer, I'm going to have to sacrifice something. That's the fear of the ego trying to step in and prevent us from really asking for the answer. Yet only by asking will you learn that nothing that is of God demands anything of you. Nothing that is of God demands anything of you. God gives, he does not take. God gives, he does not take. So when we ask for the answer from the Holy Spirit, God gives us the answer through the Holy Spirit. He does not take anything. He does not demand anything. He does not expect anything. He just wants to give to us. But we have to say, okay, I'm ready for the answer, and I no longer want the problem at all. I just want the answer. Thank you, Holy Spirit. You are refusing to ask because you believe that asking is taking, and you do not perceive it as sharing. The Holy Spirit will give you only what is yours and will take nothing in return. The Holy Spirit will only give you what is yours and will take nothing in return. This has nothing to do with taking or expecting. For what is yours is everything, and you share it with God. This is its reality. Would the Holy Spirit, who wills only to restore, be capable of misinterpreting the question you must ask to learn his answer? Again, the Holy Spirit's only function is to restore our sight, so that when our sight is restored, we look upon the new world, the real world, and we are in the kingdom of peace and joy and happiness. And it is only from this place that we can draw others in. So we're asking to be the example here, and to ask and to receive from the Holy Spirit. Ask for the answer. You have heard the answer, but you have misunderstood the question. You have believed that to ask for guidance of the Holy Spirit is to ask for deprivation. Little children of God, you do not understand your Father. You believe in a world that takes because you believe that you can get by taking. And by that perception, you have lost sight of the real world. You are afraid of the world as you see it, but the real world is still yours for the asking. Do not deny it to yourself, for it can only free you. Nothing of God will enslave his Son, whom he created free, and whose freedom is protected by his being. Blessed are you who will ask the truth of God without fear, for only thus can you learn that his answer is the release from fear. Beautiful children of God, you are asking only for what I promised you. Do you believe I would deceive you? The kingdom of heaven is within you. Believe that the truth is in me, for I know that it is in you. God's sons have nothing which they do not share. Ask for truth of any son of God, and you have asked it of me. No one of us but has the answer in him to give to anyone who asks it of him. Ask anything of God's Son, and his Father will answer you. For Christ is not deceived in his Father, and his Father is not deceived in him. I love this because the whole focus of these last few paragraphs is on the focus of asking, the importance of asking for the answer and receiving it. And the recognition of asking something of God's Son and receiving it as well. But realizing that to ask for something is not to take, it's not to get. It's literally to give. God gives his answer through the Holy Spirit to us. God gives his answer through the sons of God to us. That is the power of the one mind. And so the power of this one mind bears witness to the real world. And when we ask for the real world, so do we experience it. But we must want this. Blessed are you who will ask the truth of God without fear, for only thus can you learn that his answer is the release from fear. So fear not the fear. Ask for this without the fear, and it is yours. So let this be our practice then. Do not, then, be deceived in your brother, and see only his loving thoughts as his reality. For by denying his mind is split, you will heal yours. I'm even going to read that again, because this is our practice with every single person we think about and meet. Do not, then, be deceived in your brother, and see only his loving thoughts as your reality. For denying his mind is split, you will heal your own. By denying that his mind is split, you will heal your own. So even if he's acting split and acting crazy and acting insane, doesn't mean that that has to be our vision of him. We can deny that vision and ask to see the holy, innocent child of God there. And by seeing the holy, innocent of child of God there, we have denied the split in him, denied the split in us, and are looking upon reality. And it is that reality that we share. That's the platform for miracles right there. Accept him as his Father accepts him, and heal him unto Christ. For Christ is his healing and yours. Christ is the Son of God, who is in no way separate from his Father, whose every thought is as loving as the thought of his Father by which he was created. Be not deceived in God's Son, for thereby you must be deceived in yourself. And being deceived in yourself, you are deceived in your Father, in whom no deceit is possible. So this is why we can't heal alone, right? We have to heal with our brothers. Because either I'm seeing my brother as a body who's done such and such, hasn't done such and such, or I see him as the Christ. And what we choose to see in him, we will see in ourselves. That's the law of giving. Remember, God is only giving. As I give to my brothers, I will receive. In the real world, there is no sickness, for there is no separation and no division. And you can only be sick when you're separated from God, who is the thought of healing, right? So the real world, there is no sickness, for there is no separation and no division. Only loving thoughts are recognized. And because no one is without your help, the help of God goes with you everywhere. As you become willing to accept this help by asking for it, you will give it because you want it. as you become willing to accept this help by asking for it. You will give it because you want it. Nothing will be beyond your healing power because nothing will be denied your simple request. What problems will not disappear in the presence of God's answer? Ask then to learn of the reality of your brother, because that is what you will perceive in him, and you will see your beauty reflected in him. So ask then to learn the reality of your brother, the reality of your brother. And you will perceive it in him, and then you will see your beauty reflected in him. That's it. We don't really know that we have received the answer that the Holy Spirit's in us until we give it. That's why it's the law of giving. And these laws are God's laws. They are part of the kingdom. Right? So we really don't know that the Holy Spirit is in us or that we've received the answer until we give it. And that's why our willingness must be there to give it, to see the reality in my brothers. Do not accept your brother's variable perception of himself, for his split mind is yours. And he will not accept your healing without his. Yeah. For you share the real world as you share heaven, and his healing is yours. To love yourself is to heal yourself. And you cannot perceive part of you as sick and achieve your own goal. Brother, we heal together. As we live together and love together. Be not deceived in God's Son, for he is one with himself and one with his Father. Love him who is beloved of his Father, and you will learn of the Father's love for you. Love him who is beloved of his Father, and you will learn of the Father's love for you. If you perceive offense in a brother, pluck the offense from your mind, for you are offended by Christ and are deceived in him. Heal in Christ and be not offended by him, for there is no defense in him. If what you perceive offends you, you are offended in yourself and are condemning God's Son, whom God condemneth not. Let the Holy Spirit remove all offense of God's Son against himself and perceive no one but through his guidance, for he would save you from all condemnation. Accept his healing power and use it for all he sends you, for he wills to heal his Son of the Son of God in whom he is not deceived. I think this is so crucial. This is showing us how vigilant we have to be if we want the answer. If I want the answer, then I have to be vigilant against thinking I'm offended in some way, taking something personal in some way, thinking that someone's hurt me in some way. I have to be vigilant against that. And I have to let my mind be healed in all situations that I think I've been offended, that I think I've been hurt, that I think I'm taking something personally. Those are the times with which we have to let our minds be healed and let the Holy Spirit remove all offense of God's Son against himself, so that we no longer perceive offense as being possible for us or for others, because we realize that the only thing that is truly possible is loving a brother as yourself. That's the only true reality for all of us, loving our brothers as ourselves. So the last few paragraphs here, beautiful souls, thank you for bearing with me here today. 255. Children perceive terrifying ghosts and monsters and dragons, and they are terrified. Yet if they ask someone they trust for the real meaning of what they perceive and are willing to let their interpretations go in favor of reality, their fear goes with them. When a child is helped to translate his ghost into a curtain, his monster into a shadow, and his dragon into a dream, he is no longer afraid and laughs happily at his own fear. You, my children, are afraid of your brothers and of your father, and of yourselves, but you are merely deceived in them. Ask what they are of the teachers of reality. Ask what they are of the Holy Spirit, the teacher of reality. And hearing his answer, you too will laugh at your fears and replace them with peace. For fear lies not in reality, but in the minds of children who do not understand reality. It is only their lack of understanding which frightens them, and when they learn to perceive truly, they are not afraid. And because of this, they will ask for truth again when they are frightened. It is not the reality of your brothers or your father or yourself which frightens you. You do not know what they are, and so you perceive them as ghosts and monsters and dragons. Ask of their reality from the one who knows it, and he will tell you what they are. For you do not understand them, and because you are deceived by what you see, you need reality to dispel your fears. I don't think Jesus can stress this enough, that we are little children who know not what we do. But little child who knows not what you do, you can ask for reality to replace your dreams of fear. And so we are asking what reality is of the teacher who knows, the Holy Spirit inside our holy mind. And so we must ask him for reality. And if we don't ask him for reality, we don't want it, and we will remain suffering. We will remain in this dream of death. We will remain in pain and split-minded. But it is only when we ask the true teacher of reality what reality is that his answer will allow us to laugh away all of our fears and let all of our fears be replaced by peace and joy. And this is what we all want, truly, as equal children of God. So here is our final little paragraph here. Who would not exchange your fears of truth if the exchange is yours for the asking? Who would not exchange your fears for truth if the exchange is yours for the asking? For if God is not deceived in you, you can be deceived only in yourself. Yet you can learn the truth of yourself of the Holy Spirit, who will teach you that, as part of God, deceit in you is impossible. When you perceive yourself without deceit, you will accept the real world in place of the false one you have made. And then your Father will lean down to you and take the last step for you by raising you unto himself. How holy beautiful is this? We have a part to play in meeting the conditions for the kingdom. Meeting those conditions are seeing love without opposite, seeing goodness in our brothers without opposite, and realizing that we don't know how to see only good and only loving because we have given the meaning to everything. So we drop our meaning. We drop trying to answer ourselves. And we ask the Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit, teach me to see my brothers through the eyes of only love and through the eyes of only good. We also must be vigilant for no longer taking offense to anything, taking anything personally, seeing deceit in ourselves or anyone. And as we are vigilant on these areas and recognize when we slip into the dark spaces of deceit or offense or judgment, then we can come back to the real world by asking the Holy Spirit how to see our brothers truly. And in asking to see my brothers truly, I will see myself truly. And as we take this step to truly heal our minds with the Holy Spirit, we are meeting the conditions for the kingdom. And then we are realizing here, and then your Father will lean down to you and take the last step for you by raising you unto himself. And by raising us unto him doesn't mean we're leaving something, doesn't mean we're sacrificing something. It literally means that God is giving himself to us. He's giving all of himself to us, which is that perfect love without opposite, which is that perfect joy without opposite, which is the kingdom of heaven. And then he restores us back to the light-filled mind that is his own, so we can carry his presence into this world and work miracles here, so that we can bring all of the world to the happy dream and wake up and go back home to him. That's where we come from. That's where we've never left. That's where we're going. So let's make this faster for ourselves, shall we? So we've realized today that there's one problem, that's separation, and the one answer comes from the Holy Spirit, and that is of our united identity in Christ and in God. And so at first we don't know what that means, we don't know what that looks like, but we are being taught every step of the way, and we know that it's possible. So there's hope, there's a direction, there's a goal, and there's a purpose that we share. So let's remember this purpose and this goal today. Let's let this goal and this purpose of happiness and the answer and the new world be our goal, so that we truly can be of greatest service here and heal our minds faster and heal our brothers with us, that we truly can be at peace. Because remember, God wills us only perfect happiness, and peace is synonymous with happiness. So he's rooting for us. The Holy Spirit's rooting for us. All our holy brothers are rooting for us. I'm rooting for us. And so there's nothing that's stopping us but our own fear. But let's remember that the source of this fear is the only problem. So we're asking for the answer and the correction to this fear. And that answer ultimately undoes all the fear anyway. So don't listen to that fear that chirps. Doesn't mean anything. It's not real. So I love you, beautiful souls. I'm so grateful that I read through this with all of you guys today in one continual fashion. It is a little bit longer of a video, but it is worth it. And so thank you for being present. I love you. God bless you. Mwah. And may we all reside in the Holy Kingdom now and forever and always. Mwah. I love you.